My name is Keith M. Little. I am a Navajo code talker serving in the United States Marine Corps during World War II. I live here in Crystal, but originally I was born in Twin Helene, Arizona. My brand to the almighty people is Tchodachini, bitter water. Then many goats, Tlazasana. Those are my dad's people, my dad's clan. And then Tapahaikalso, Edge Water Meadow people, is my grandpa's. And then my grandparents, my paternal grandparents is Kia'ani, Shinale, and this Taurian House clan. So that is my identification to as a Navajo. You know, I was an orphan, being raised by my sisters and relatives. When I came into the world and when I noticed that the world around me, I noticed there was a man and a woman, and also my two nieces. But the girls, they called the man and the woman my mom and dad, my father and my mother. But for me, I was just a stranger.
Keith Little attended boarding school at Ganado Mission School.
I don't know the word stupid, but dumb, I think I heard that too many times. So that's the way boarding school was. They copied the military discipline. The only thing is that you're punished.
At Ganado Mission School, during a cookout, students heard about the Japanese attack on America, Pearl Harbor.
Pearl Harbor? Well, it happened on Sunday. On this certain day, forgot any of us to bring some salt. And salt is what we eat, we season the food. And that made the meat taste better. So when we cooked the meat, then somebody says, salt. Where's the salt? Found out there wasn't any. So the best runner out of the group, he went back to the dormitory and stole some salt over there, borrowed it or something. Come on back. But when he come back to us and he says, here's the salt. Do you know that United States has been attacked? We're in a war. We started a war. Sneak attack. And a lot of us, when we heard that word, sneak attack, how did they do it anyway? Right away, they must really be sneaky people, you know. How could they do that? Maybe the army and the armed forces in Hawaii, or maybe they're asleep. Get caught with their pants down. That's the way we felt, and we felt anger. A mental anger creep into our minds. And there was a broadcast going on from Washington, D.C. President Roosevelt was going to talk. And in it, He said, "This is a day of infamy." And I heard that distinctly, and I remember it distinctly. Our matron, when the man said, Roosevelt said, that we may have to go to war, and she moaned. "Oh," she said, the matron. She was an elderly woman, white. And I wonder why. Why she gave a moan. So I managed to ask her. I said, "Miss Simons, how come you give a moan when the president said that we may have to go to war?" Then she said, "War is terrible. You cannot think of going to war because some of you are going to get hurt, get killed. You're going to be in a war." In summer of 1942, many of my buddies went home. And from there, they enlisted in the Marine Corps. And then I found out that at the post office, there's a poster hanging in there. Somewhere where you can see that United States Marine Corps was the greatest fighting people in the world. And that is, when I glance at it, that's what I want. So I was only 16 years old at the time, in the summer of 1942. So on my 17th birthday, a day after I got leave and went to Gallup and enlisted in the Marine Corps. So the guy I was with, I guess he lied about his age also. I didn't know that. He was talking about, you know, if his elderly, if his guardians will not give permission for him to go to go into the service. So he said that, well, I know my mom is not going to some print the paper, the permission. I know that my dad is not going to do it. And my grandpa, I don't know he said, "You take care of the animals right here until you're old enough to go to war." So things like that, you know, he had doubts. And He schemed. He suggested that, you know, there's an old man out here, you know, he's got a flock of sheep that he takes care of every day. He herds sheep out to the east of Fort Defiance. And sometimes he goes over there and visit with him. And so why don't we ask him? That time, thumbprint was a signature, legal signature. So we ask him, and right away he says, "Yeah, I'll do it." Well, he said, "Grandpa, you have just thumbprinted for us to go a paper that says authorization to go into the Marine Corps. So we're going to go to war." Well, "I'm glad I did that," he says. "We need young men and of your age over there that are strong. I want you to kill just as many Japanese as possible, Slant Eyes." That's the way he put it. So that was a cheering squad for us.
After Keith enlisted in the Marine Corps, he was sent to Camp Pendleton for training.
DI asked me, "Are you American Indian?" I said, "Yes, sir." And then, "By any chance, are you a Navajo?" I said, "Yes, sir." Well, it was not to my knowledge that they were using Navajos to make the for secret communication, and this is what they were involved in. And I guess they billed it as a special duty. They took us to Camp Pendleton. Navajo Communication School training. And that's where we learned that out of our eyes are astonishments that the Navajos were being used, Navajo language is being used as a code. You know, there's about 20 of us that started class in 1943, summer of 1943. And that's how I got into communication. So we learned it and we qualified and we went overseas and went into Roy Namora and Saipan and Tinian and Iwo Jima. And I guess it's just like a football game, you know, you're on a team and you got your first game and you wonder what's going to happen to you. You wonder how you're going to do. And you just want to survive. Well, during my first battle in the Marshall Islands, we landed on Namor. Namor is an island connected by causeway to Roy. And Roy is an ammunition dump and got an airfield there. But anyway, it took us 2 days to secure the island. There was a little steel reinforced concrete building with a wide door. And we didn't pay any attention to it because it didn't have. The door was really locked, I guess. But I see the door, we seen the door open, you know, we watch it. And pretty soon there's a white flag coming out on a stick. So there was somebody inside, a group of men, so everybody trained their rifle on the target. He came out through the door and stepped about a few steps away from the door. And he didn't have any weapon. He didn't have any clothes on except for a G-string around his bottom. About that time, somebody shot. And then everybody started shooting. And meantime, the man got down and he started running. Right, the nearest protection is about 10 feet away, the crater. So he dove in there. And the platoon leader was yelling all the time. He says, cease fire, God damn it. If you can't shoot him, leave him alone. And then the firing stopped and he says, "I'll be goddamn," he says. "What kind of Marines do I have anyway? can't even shoot an enemy 10 feet away." For me, anyway, I think about the holy people. All right, you're going to protect me. I want to go through these difficult times. That is probably my last thought before I start running someplace. And then I make it to the other side and surprise myself by getting there. And you learn as you go along.
When the war ended in 1945, Keith returned home, thankful to be alive.
You know, I find that a lot of people that have seen the worst end of it don't talk about it, because they think that the people that got killed, the soldiers that got killed, the Marines that got killed, they made the supreme sacrifice, while I'm thankful that I came back. And there's a lot of guilty feeling on the survivors, although they were in it. So there it is. I guess I'm lucky, I'm fortunate, and you're thankful that you survive beyond being thankful for an ordinary person that never seen a war.
Keith Little is president of the Navajo Code Talker Association. One of the organization's main goals is the construction of the Navajo Code Talkers Museum near Wind Rock, Arizona.
And in the museum, it will tell the true story. The real, what do you call it, ethical story of how the code, the military code, was thought of, and they developed it, and the Navajos, they developed it and utilized it in the war, and that became a non-unbreakable code, the most dependable, reliable, and secure form of communication for battlefield uses.
In 2000, the Navajo Code Talkers were recognized for their service when they received congressional medallions from the United States President.
When they honored us to get our congressional medal, silver medal, the other guys, the 29, they went to Washington and they got a gold medal. And here those of us that are not just ordinary Marine Code Talkers, we got the silver one. And I said, what is this for? What do you think about it, to my buddy? And one guy says, just maybe, I have finally become American citizen.